Stravinsky, or we'll talk about contractions of science, aggregate, and
dynamics. Thank you very much. It's a great
So today I will speak about what happens in
hyperplane and a bit of Calabi-Yau manifold when you take birational contraction. This is of course not the whole story about what happens with birational maps, but if we understand the birational map, which are maps which are holomorphic, we understand something. And in many ways, it's already a lot. Okay, so the idea is what we have: M to M prime is, but suppose it's birational map. Is called contraction, birational contraction, if it is holomorphic. Okay, so for instance, for T3, the birational contractions are classified.
Do you assume that X is normal?
X is normal. No, I don't assume that, but.
Then you can just do the points.
Okay, well, let's assume. Well, right. Mm-hmm. Let's assume that X is normal for simplicity. Anyway, 2 points is not interesting because it doesn't give you any contraction loci, which should be rational curves or unions of rational curves. Anyway, for T3, you understand. And for general Calabi-Yau manifold, that you have the birational contraction loci. Loci is the exceptional sets. Components, irreducible components of exceptional sets. So the idea is to somehow to understand, to classify the birational contraction loci in reasonable situations, and the typical reasonable situation is Calabi-Yau, where you have we know that the birational contraction locus is union of rational curves. So it's union rule. Thanks. Okay. And the other example where we understand at least almost everything is Hilbert scheme. So suppose you have a T3, say, and you have its Hilbert scheme, which was already defined yesterday, so I won't tell much about it. Okay, if you have a contraction for T3 to something, to X, then you have a contraction for the Hilbert scheme to X, to the Hilbert scheme of X. And if you are lucky enough and for instance, your T3 is entirely non-algebraic with algebraic dimension 0, then this is essentially the whole contraction you can have. You can have also another contraction, which is just contraction to symmetric power. And that's all contraction which are possible to have for non-algebraic for the scheme of non-algebraic episodes. So we understand something, and the idea to classify contractions is to use deformation theory. We know that these guys are essentially bands in the set of all deformations of inputs. So if we understand, if we could somehow understand what happens with contraction loci where you deform a manifold, then we would complete the classification and get some information, at least for Hilbert scheme. But it's a separate question, which is also interesting, just to see how the contraction looks like depend on the deformation. So this is,
In this example, why can't you consider the map to the symmetric power of X?
Yeah, of course, of X. But this is composition of two contractions. You contract this to here and then this. So at least we, So the idea is that we have some I will explain it, but I can tell you the geometric picture now. We have some certain contraction loci, which are unions of rational curves, and we can just kill them all one after another or separately. And the idea is to classify these rational curves, essentially. And of course, to understand what is the shape, the geometric shape of this loci. Okay, so before I go on, let me tell you a couple of words about hyperkeller manifolds. I will be very brief because it's not essential, but still I should at least spend some time. And the idea is that M is holomorphically symplectic, a Keller, compact, Keller type. This is the same as hyperkeller. Of course, when people say hyperkeller, they usually mean that you have three complex structures, you have quadratic relations between them, and so on and so forth. And I'm not going to use that, so you can see that on the slide, but I'm not going to apply, I think, never, this quadratic structure, which is, of course, nice and pleasant. The only thing which I will use for terminology, I will say the word Holomy group, but the idea is that if you have this hyperkeller thing with three complex structures and the metric gives you the Lebesgue connection, preserving your three complex structures, and then you have Holomy group of this metric, which also preserves three complex structures. And then the group which is obtained by parallel transport, is an important invariant of a hyperkeller metric, which I'm not going to use. Instead, I will just cheat a bit. And so this is what you have on the top. Of course, if you have this holomorphic symplectic Keller type manifold compact, it always has this hyperkeller structure in the sense of having three complex structures. And it is unique by collabial theorem, so we'll use this as a definition. And then, what is another important point? We say that M has maximal holomy. Maximal holomy. Also known as irreducible holomorphic symplectic. If P1 of M is 0 and H2 0, this is the group where symplectic form lives, of M is C. This is a standard assumption, which I will assume. And of course, for Hilbert scheme of K3, this is okay. These assumptions are true for a Hilbert scheme. And if you have another hyperkeller manifold, holomorphic symplectic, then you have Bogomolov decomposition theorem, which says that you have a finite cover, and this finite cover is a product of these guys, the maximal holomy, and just torus, which has trivial holomy. Okay, am I clear? Please ask questions because I'm doing slightly fast. So maybe I should spend more time, but this is the only thing I'm going to use anyway. So this is the holomorphic symplectic Keller type manifold. And you have this running assumption, which is reducibility. Essentially, this, your manifold is not locally a product. And if it is locally a product, then after a finite covering, it becomes a globally a product, and we don't want them because, I mean, if you understand the elementary bits, then you can work with the product, and that's not a big deal. Okay, but please ask questions if I'm going too fast or something. Now, why did I need that? This is because the maximum Holomy assumption brings you huge restrictions on the topology of your manifold. So if you have M is called hyperkeller, maximal holomy, you have the Fujita theorem, which is the following. Consider the polynomial P, which maps H to M, say Q or Z, let's say Z, to Z. taken eta and put into integral over n of eta power 2n, where n, 2n is complex dimension of n. N is homomorphic symmetric, so the complex dimension is obviously E even. And then you have this map, and which is polynomial, but, well, it's not only polynomial. It has lots of symmetries which come from the Hodgkin position. This is clearly symmetric under the Hodgkin position, and there are lots of different Hodgkin positions on your hyperplanar manifold because of deformation theory. And then the theorem of Hodgkin says that P of eta is some constant lambda times Q of eta eta power n, where Q is quadratic form. This was observed by Bogomolov, then by Bavit and Fujiki. So it's called Bogomolov. Outside of Japan, it's mostly just Bogomolov Bavit form. So, but it's so, sort of easier to call it BBF. And F is important to distinguish. Okay. There is an explicit form of this formula, which is due to, I guess, Bagi. And, yeah, a couple of words. First, this relation, let's assume that the Q is primitive, not divisible by anything, and integer, then this relation entirely determines Q, except by the sign. If n is odd, the sign is okay. If n is even, you should really fix the sign, and to fix the sign, you write this. This is the only functionality of this formula, but it also helps if you want to compute it explicitly. For instance, you can compute it on the three-dimensional space generated by your omega, omega bar, which is holomorphic symmetric form. Holomorphic symmetric form conjugate, so it's like real and imaginary part of holomorphic symmetric form, and the Keller form. And it turns out that this is the form which has the same, I mean, it's positive definite on that space, negative definite on the atom complement, so it works entirely like the Hodge, Riemann-Hodge form on H2 or Riemann-Hodge form on KT. You have Hodge index theorem, you have everything as if you work on a surface. So people who like hyperplanar manifolds, they usually think of them as surfaces because, for instance, dynamics is the same as for surfaces. So it's like generalization of K3, but in many senses it remains two-dimensional. Okay. Now let's speak a bit about curves. So if you have 2 points and you have a rational curve passing through these 2 points, then you can always deform it unless it's rigid. So definition, if you have x, y, 2 points in M, and C a rational curve passing through, containing, so it's, it contains x and y, then there exists a point, another curve, another rational curve, C prime, containing x and y, and rigid non-deformations. This is essentially a Mori bend and break. Okay, so now we can take general points and call it minimal if rigid of course in the set of all curves passing, containing x and y. Okay, such a curve always exists, and we call it minimum. And then of course,
if you have a curve, it's always homologous to a sum of minimal curves. So, and now the definition. This is called extremal. If Q of CC is n, and it is minimal. This makes sense because, of course, the homology class of C is homology class of C is LH2 Fn, but we have the Gamow Bailey form, Gamow Bailey for Jacobi form, which identifies this space with H2 of n by duality. So we always identify these two spaces, and then we have the form. Okay, so this makes sense, and this is the curves which are boundary on of Keller cones, as you will see next slide.
So we could be interested. Okay, what is Keller cone? Keller cone is union of all Keller classes. So. Definition, Keller cone of n is union, it sits in H11 of n, reveal coefficients, it's open there, and it's the union, a set of all Keller classes. It turns out that the set can be characterized in terms of the Rechon curves, and then, in fact, it's another, there's another characterization in terms of the conduction loss A. So let's call concept. Yeah, first notice that H11 of MR has signature 1 B2 minus 3. So this is because I told you about how the Gamow-Bailey form works as positive definite on three-dimensional space generated by 2002 and Keller form, which sits there, and negative definite on the atomic component, which entirely sits there. So this is hyperbolic space. And then you have the set, like the set of all eta inside H11, such that eta square, Q of eta, eta, is positive. This is the usual cone in the hyperbolic space. It has two components, like that. And then we take one of these components called positive of M, positive cone, is one which contains Keller cone. Really, any form in a Keller, any Keller form square gives. Positive, this is I already tried to explain. So Q of omega omega is positive. So this, but Keller form is convex, so it's connected, it sits in one of two components, and this is the component which is called positive cone. And then you can describe the positive cone in terms of this curve which I just erased. So you take helium, which is, well, it's a nice helium. You can prove it as an exercise if you ever use the Mani-Pavan characterization of Keller cone or more redundant breaking in the predictive case. So Keller cone of M is the set of all eta inside positive cone, such that eta restricted to to any for each extremal. So it, you restrict eta to a curve, you obtain a number, and it should be positive for each extremal curve. In particular, if you have no extremal curves, which might happen even for K3 or as happens for torus, then this is empty condition, and you have positive cone the same as Keller cone. But for general situation, of course, you have the positive cone is split on to what is called
Weyl chambers or Keller chambers. I will explain about that in a moment. Okay, now, yeah, turns out that this guy, the Keller cone, is oblique polyhedral, and its faces are orthogonal complement to extremal curves. Well, this is just the same, and it, you can deduce it from Carnot at base point 3, which I will tell you now. Okay, there's another characterization of bilateral contraction, which is due to, well, just follows, it works for all Calabria, yeah, it just follows from the Kalamata Boyce point 3 in that particular case. This is a very important theorem and very powerful, but it becomes completely, like, almost elementary in applications, not in proof, of course, proof is the same, for Calabria. Because the big statement is somehow complicated, and for Calabria, this complicated statement becomes easy. So definition, base point set of a bundle A is a set of all, it's wrong by the way, what is written there, I'm sorry, it's a set of all X inside M such that for each section gamma inside H0 of A power n, and should be, here it is A, I'm sorry about this, gamma in X is equal to 0. This is the base point set. Now, of course, if you have 0 base point set, you have just a holomorphic map associated with the sections of this bundle. In particular, for ample bundle, the base point set is trivial, but generally, so definition, A has no base points. It's called semi-ample. So semi-ample bundles correspond to holomorphic maps.
Like some multiple.
Yeah.
Some multiple of L.
M multiplied.
This is wrong definition. Sorry. No. This is, I corrected that. Because really, when you say base point, you don't mean the sections of A, you mean sections of power of A. I think there's, in the literature, there's some distinction between this definition and
usual base functions. This is what you define as a base logic, it's called stable base.
Oh, stable base. So
yes,
this is
right.
This is what is. Okay, good. Well, somebody told me I am wrong in that usage. Anyway, but then what is in there is correct, and what is in there is correct, but the definitions are different. Anyway, so, yeah. So definition is net, which we had already in Andrea's lecture. A is net if C1 of A belongs to the closure of Keller cone. And now definition A is big if, now you take asymptotics of this, of the dimension of the space of sections. H0 of A power n, and it should be O of dimension of a manifold, which is 2n. Here it's probably just dimension of n power n. This is the maximum possible dimension. Of course, for NF bundles, you can just assume that this would be equivalent for NF, this would be equivalent to C1 of n. To top power to dimension of M is positive. But generally, it's, you should really assume the asymptotic condition. Okay, I am not going to use the notion of big, I just needed to state the Kalamata base point 3. And
suppose that L is an F and N L minus a canonical bundle is big. Then L is symmetric. Okay, so in our case, the application of this theorem is much easier because Km is trivial. So if M is Calabi-Yau, Calabi-Yau is manifold of trivial canonical bundle and Hilbert type. Of course, this should be assumed that M is projective. Without the Bikinit assumption, do I have it here? No. This is really essential, unfortunately. You have to say that.
If, and
you, yeah?
If it's scalar, and since you have a big line bundle on it, it's Moishe sum. So it's scalar and Moishe sum, so it implies that it's projective.
That's,
so, you,
yeah.
Yes, it's essential because it's can only be.
State.
Can only exist in the projective case. It's the trick.
Okay. But you'll see that in some point we really like the non-projective version of Kawamata-based point theory. You'll see. It's actually a big question which I'm going to ask. Okay. If M is Calabi-Yau, Kn is zero. This means that if L is big enough, then L is symmetric. Okay, you can also check that this asymptotic is actually dimension, the asymptotic of the growth is actually dimension of the image of the M under the map associated with A. So also the corresponding map. Is birational conduction. In other words, if we want to understand birational conduction, we just need to see what points there are on the boundary of the Hilbert cone, but not on the part of the boundary which is squared to zero, but on the like in the interior part of the positive cone and on the boundary of the Hilbert cone. This is the same as conduction. Okay, so we are interested in the walls of the Hilbert cone. But you know that they are flat because there are orthogonal complements to the extremal curves. Okay. Now, this is... we can sort of try to understand what is the fibers of this conduction map and definition. X or S is called rationally connected. Connected. If for each point X and Y inside X there exists a chain of rational curves connecting X to Y, and in fact, if X is smooth, then a posteriori there exists just one rational curve. But we don't assume that it is smooth, so it's really a chain. And remark, or a theorem actually, if M is Calabi-Yau, and you have a birational conduction of Calabi-Yau. The fibers of psi are rational connected. So the fibers are actually unions of rational curves. For hypercoidal, it's apparently not a complicated result, and for Calabi-Yau slightly more complicated. I think that correct reference is
some paper of Adam McGurnan. Okay, so now if we have the remark again, if we have eta, integer class, each 1, 1 of n z, eta square is positive, eta on the boundary of 1 boundary of Pelican, then eta, this bundle of the n c1 of n is eta, then eta is big, a is big, and gives gives variational conduction.
Okay.
And what is important, so what does it contract? Obviously it contracts all curves which are contracting, all curves C such that C and A is zero. It contracts all these curves, and this is, it doesn't contract anything else because we know that the fibers are covered by curves. So how we will obtain the central variational conduction? We just find a minimal curve which is such that, which is orthogonal to it, such that n restricted to the curves is zero, and contract it. Contract all such curves and we are done. So the contraction loci at least were important moment that if you have, if you are a projective manifold and you have this wall of the Keller cone, it always contains a rational point. So you need that to be integer, the point on the boundary, and you can find it. If it's not projective, you cannot, so you can't apply the theorem of Kalmata. Okay, but still it's much easier and you get more information to work for non-projective manifolds. So this is the idea. Now I will give you another definition of what is called ambient class, and it is not related to conductions. So the idea is that what I now give you a definition of the case we should contract if it is projective, and they might contract if Kalamata is true for non-projective situation. Okay, so suppose you have a definition. Suppose you have eta on the boundary of a Keller cone. So it's in the so you can either start with a curve or you can start with the maybe I should just skip to another slide and give you the right definition. So theorem. Let S be the set of all Kalmogorov classes of all extremal curves on all deformations of M. And then you can take S orthogonal is union, it sits in the second cohomology in H2 of MR, a union of all orthogonal components to S. Then Taylor cone is positive cone without connected component of positive cone without this set S apple. Okay, so what happens? We are we sort of understand that the volts of the Keller cone are precisely extreme curves. But this is topological data. You just take all classes of all extreme curves and you take the volts associated with that. And it turns out that this is precisely the volts of the Keller cone. So the Keller cone, like, let's suppose it's two-dimensional. For simplicity, it looks like that. Where here you have all cohomology classes, which can be a cohomology classes of an extremal curve. So definition, these cohomology classes at the inside S are called ambient classes. And another remark, that all connected components, like on 4K3, all connected components of M without, positive cone without S orthogonal are Keller cones for other birational models, for birational models of M. So you start with the manifold, and by the theorem of Huygens, which I didn't mention, but I really should have done that, all birational, all holomorphic syndactic manifolds which are birational to M are actually diffeomorphic to M. So you can start with M, you can flip some, obtain another manifold which is birational to it, and you will have another cone somewhere within the point. Okay. So I don't have much time to explain how it is done, but the idea is that you can, if you have the minimal curve, you can actually deform it. Minimal curve can be deformed along with the deformation of the manifold. This is just deformation theory similar to Moore. You just compute the dimensions. And then this means that this line somehow is deformed with the as you deform the manifold. And then if it is not of this type, if it can be represented by a curve, then you can actually find a hyperkinematic for that this curve is not doesn't give you a wall of the Keller cone, so it you can do what is called twister lines and somehow cover the orthogonal complement to this curve by twister lines. Never mind. The idea is that the proof is simple and but entirely non-algebraic.
Okay.
So you use the deformation stability for the curves, and for the classes which are not represented by curves, you use derivatives.
Okay.
Now let me finally state the main result. Okay, as I told you, the walls of the Keller cone survive. If you deform your manifold in such a way that the ambient class reminds of type 1-1, it reminds the wall of a Keller cone. So this means that you have the whole deformation families of manifolds which admit homomorphic contractions. And the idea is that we can study the centers of these homomorphic contractions, birational contractions, under deformation. So this is the main result. How much time do I have?
20 minutes.
Good. So I will have even some time to give you the proof. But now I can at least state the main result. Which but everything
the
is due to
the statement is actually wrong.
Could be.
Because you must ask more of your CIs. Not only do they have to remain one of type 1-1, but they have to remain faces, actual faces of the Keller cone. Right. So we are working.
You have to do birational transport. You work with the
with the face. So when we move the corner structure, we have to move the color cone as well, but we can do that if you look at this. Anyway, so we have this the set of MBM classes, and we can consider the, well, here it is stated for intersection, for some deeper variational contraction, which can be done by taking successive contraction with the serial curves. Let me just state it in a simple way, without these complicated matters. So let Z be contraction be MBM class. So it's NH2 of MR. RZ is MBM class. And then we can have M1 and M2, two manifolds, deformation of a hypercalian manifold, such that Z orthogonal is a face of Keller cone on M1 and M2. By face, I mean you have a boundary which is union of flat pieces because it's polyhedral, and this is codimension one face in that polyhedral. So it's codimension one face. Then you have this thing. Then you have this is represented by a curve, and take Z1 and Z2 union of all curves, it's better to say extremal curves in commodity class of Z in M1 and M2. Then Z1 is homomorphic to Z2. Okay, this is slightly funny. When I first gave a talk about that, I told that they're diffeomorphic, but this is not true. So in fact, you have a homomorphism, moreover. There exists a homomorphism from M1 to M2, mapping Z1 to Z2. Of course, these two manifolds, they are deformation equivalent. They are diffeomorphic, but there is no natural homomorphic map between them. However, if this is rationally connected, then this map is in fact this map, does it have a name? Psi. Psi maps minimum curves in Z1 to minimum curves in Z2. In fact, if this would be very smooth and rationally connected, then this already implies that the map is bihomomorphic. Because if you have a homomorphism preserved by rational curves or a rationally connected manifold, it's actually bihomomorphic. It's not hard to see. But otherwise, it's definitely not a bihomomorphism. And in fact, if this is very singular, it's not even diffeomorphic. Only information you have is that it is a memory.
Okay. So the
kind of stratified diffeomorphism.
Yeah, that's true. In fact, there are several. I will tell this when I will explain the proof. But then idea that the curve survives, it's an old idea. It's due to Zeran and Clairvoisin that if you have a rational curve, minimal rational curve fundamental, you deform the convex structure, the curve survives. So the news here is that the union of curves not only survives, but remains a monomorphic to itself. Okay, a couple of words about technical space. So the idea is that you can use deformation theory to apply it to hyperplane manifolds, even in complex geometry, and in fact it's very nice. So by definition, technical space is just all complex structures up to connected component diffeomorphisms. So this is isotopy group. Isotopy is connected, diffeomorphism is connected to unity, and this is all complex structures. These are two infinidimensional spaces, but the quotient finidimensional, in fact, it is smooth and complex manifold, but not closed. So take is not all. Smooth. For hyperplane, when M is hyperplane. Generally, it is complex variety, but, well, it's not even variety if you do it in big generality. Yes. No. But for Taleb, yeah, at least it is a nice. Nice thing. Okay, now you have Mach and Planck group. Gamma is div by div zero, acts on pig, and the quotient is a set of all complex structures up to equivalence. The point is that this set is entirely bad in the sense that gamma acts on pig with dense orbits. Gamma acts on T with dense orbits. Somehow this doesn't stop us working with the space, but it puts an end to some hopes of having like nice coarse deformation space. So we don't have coarse deformation space, but in fact we have something like a fine deformation space in the following sense that this guy take. In fact, it has universal bundle on it. So, and this I'm going to use. So for each point of t, there is a complex structure associated with it. And in fact, you can glue them together to obtain a deformation of complex structures, like a holomorphic family of manifolds with complex structure over the t nullary space. Okay. Dense orbits, and in fact, you can describe what orbits are non-dense. But I'm not going to tell much here. What I'm going to tell is that now the main ingredient of the argument, except technical theory, is this theorem of Tom Mather. I stated here about homomorphic families, but you don't need that. In fact, it's true for all proper real analytic families. So let me state it here like that. In fact, it's Porusinski as well. I will explain where Porusinski input. So suppose you have M over B proper family of real and parallels, real and proper family. You don't need your B to be compact, but the fibers should be compact. Then there exists a specification of B real analytic such that up psi is trivial. We should put quotes on it. Trivial. I will explain why it is quotes. Trivial over all open strata. Open strata means you take the stratum and you remove substrata. Trivial over all open strata. Trivial in the following sense. So first you can have. So first it is homomorphically trivial in the sense that all fibers, like fibers over open strata, are anamorphic. Second, you have a stratification of these fibers by, like Whitney stratification, by, because it's real empty, so you can stratify it by smooth varieties of different dimensions. And then this map, the trivialization, will induce diffeomorphism on this open strata of the fibers. And finally, this map is also by Lipschitz in the sense of preserving, distorting the natural metric in a very small way. This is Prusin's name. So this map is, by Lipschitz maps are very good. For instance, there are almost everywhere diffeomorphisms. So in the end, we obtain that it is almost diffeomorphism, but not quite. Okay, now we can I can return to the situation with the Hilbert, with the Tagmuir space and the this MDM locus, which is bilateral contraction locus for the projective situation. So you have take. But consider, instead of all t, consider kz, which is here it is called tf. Tz, it's a set of all I inside t, such that your given z is of type h1 of type 1-1 of mi. And I will take some connected component of that if it's not connected, but it's usually connected. And then we take z is mm plus. This implies that, in fact, it's not Hausdorff, so you can also have to write min here, in the sense that z is a boundary of curved components on I, and also. If you take the evaluate curved cone on Z, you will have something non-negative. But this means that Z actually is represented by a curve. Z is represented by a curve for each I mi. Okay, this is part of the parcel which I explained. This is actually not mostly due to Zeebrand and Clairvoisin that you can deform a curve with a matrix. Now, for each of these curves, which are obtained in this Kamogi class, you can take the corresponding locus. So you have MDM locus, which is union of all minimal curves. Well, you might need to take the closure because deformation is not always minimal. Minimal curves in this common class. So you have your tazy, which is mean is for just to avoid some complications with non-holomorphisms. Then you have the universal family on there. And inside the universal family you have the locus, the MDM locus. This whole thing sits over the base. Okay, now first you have a stratification, and second you have denservance. Let's consider the biggest star, where everything is trivial. Then, so on the biggest atom. This family is locative. And this big straton is a gamma invariant. It is a gamma, well, we should take gamma z because we don't want to, we want to, our Mecklenburg class group to preserve z. Okay, this means that you have open invariant open set. And then you just use a part of the Teichmuller theorem, the what is called Ratner theorem, to check that outside of the maximum Picard. Did I tell you that this is, you should assume that your Picard group is not maximum? This is essential from the I forgot, but it's there. We assume that neither M nor M1 has maximum Picard. So outside of maximum Picard, this set of dense orbits, actually all orbits are dense. This means that all orbits... I am slightly simplifying, but anyway, what is true is that all orbits are... intersect this Zariski open set, which is the biggest target. And then you obtain that your vibration is actually a locally trivial in outside of your closed orbits, outside of the orbits corresponding to the maximum Picard that are up here. So let me just explain. You have this vibration, you have group action, the most orbits are dense, and it's locally trivial over some open set, but since most orbits are dense, this open set has to contain the all dense orbits. Then it is locally trivial everywhere outside of the maximum Picard group.
Now I have a question. Do I have 2 minutes? Okay.
So this is the definition which I told, maybe you are reading, but it's really important. MBM locus is just union of all MBM curves. This is our friends, the minimal curves, minimal extremal curves in a given commodity class. And we know by the argument which I gave to you that MBM loci are actually contactable. This is contaction loss, centers. Definition. MBM loci are unions of MBM curves in a given commodity class. Okay, so where M is projective, it is the same as contraction centers. MBM loci, same as contraction centers. What about non-projective? So what happens? You have this nice family, the Teichmuller family, and the projective points are dense. Now you have this family of MBM loci, which is locally trivial. Inside your big family of hypercoherent manifolds deformed over the Teichmuller space. And you can, for projective points, you can contract this loci. The question is how we can contract them for the non-projective case. The problem is, of course, that to contact them in projective case, we found a line bundle on the boundary of Keller-Kuhn. We applied the Kalamata BPF. Now there is no line bundle. All boundary of the Keller-Kuhn sits. There's no rational points in there, so you cannot apply. There's just no line bundles to apply to Kalamata. But still, they seem to be contactable. And it would be very, really nice to prove, at least we would avoid lots of complicated terminology, to prove that everything contacts outside of the projective case.
Or maybe it would be easier to formulate the question in the following way. You take a class, which gives you such a ball of your Keller cone, and then you take the union of all rational curves whose class is proportional to that one. So
yes.
This you can contract by Kavamat and EPF. In the projective case, what about the non-projective?
Thank you very much, yes. Yeah, this is probably better formulation. But anyway, so you have this family you want to contact, and this is an interesting question which I'm asking all specialists and non-specialists, of course. If somebody can help us, we'll be grateful. Thank you very much.
Questions? Comments? This exceptional rules. Can you say more about these fibers or exceptional rules?
Yeah, I can tell you.
Or you just accept any rule. For example, for K3, it's just a smooth rational curve.
Yeah.
Can you say that it is normal?
Oh, thank you very much. Actually, it's so with generally we have nothing, but we have for very explicit computations for Hilbert scheme of 2 points. There is just two types of, well, three types of loci which can be contact. There are two smooth derivatives and a smooth CPA2. That's all. And they live in the families, you can very easily to contact them. And so this actually, somehow the whole setup is very well suited to see that for second Hilbert scheme, and in fact for bigger dimensional Hilbert scheme, it seems to work as well. But it's slightly more complicated because we don't understand the lattice as well as for second Hilbert. But I think that for all examples which we encounter, it's actually smooth.
Can it be usually or small, right?
Yeah, that could be any dimension. For K3 it's divisorial or Lagrangian, but for bigger dimension you can have any dimension of the conduction.
Well, it can be reducible, of course.
Yeah, you can take all units.
As well as in the case of K3, or
of course, but then, I mean,
those are elementary.
But then they commute, you can take them in succession. Mm-hmm. So it's not as bad.
Also, you mean
that minus two curves are not in the same homology level, of course. Yes. But in this case, it's not clear. I think you, a priori, you might have the same homology class and the curve which deforms in several various components.
Though
it doesn't happen for Hilbert scheme of 2 points on
mm-hmm.
at least. This is one
yes,
the example which
one
doesn't
know.
Yeah.
The case of surfaces is very specific.
I think we can sort of prove it for all Hilbert schemes.
Any further questions? Well, it's all good.
Thank you very much.